Hello everyone, this is Alejandro Rios with another video tutorial about electricity, and in this presentation we're going to talk about conductors, insulators and semiconductors. I hope you like the presentation, and let's begin with it. According to the ability to transfer electric charge, materials may be classified as conductors, insulators or semiconductors. We're going to explain each of these categories during the whole presentation. Conductors are materials that show very low resistance to the flow of electric charge, so it is very easy to transfer electric charge through conductors. It is common to find conductors either as a metal or as a liquid or as a gas. If the conductor is found as a metal, the electric charge is carried by electrons. That is so because in the structure of a metal, we have available electrons that can be carried through the structure of the metal. Those electrons are called free electrons. They move freely or almost freely through the whole structure of the metal. So the flow of charge, or the flow of the electric charge through the material, is due to the flow of free electrons through the structure of the metal. Examples of conductors found as metal are aluminum, copper, zinc, gold, silver, and iron. We find them in utensils we use to cook food and utensils we use to eat food, just like forks, knives, spoons, and we might find them in bracelets and necklaces as well. Conductors found as liquid are also called electrolytes. In this case, electric charge is carried by positive and negative ions. A positive ion is an atom or a molecule with electron deficiency, and a negative ion is an atom or a molecule with excess electron. Examples of conductors found as liquid are potable water, seawater, and car battery acid. Lastly, we find conductors in the state of gas. They are also called plasma. In this case, electric charge is carried by electrons and positive ions. Examples of conductors found as gas is the ionized neon gas in a neon lamp. Insulators are materials that show very high resistance to electric charge flow. So, insulators will resist to have electric charge passing through their structure. Examples of insulators are air, plastics, ceramics, rubber, styrofoam, glass, and paper. In the case of insulators, we have a special property that is called dielectric strength, which is the maximum opposition an insulator can withstand without undergoing electrical breakdown and becoming electrically conductive. An analogy for this concept is the strength of a rubber band. A rubber band can be stretched up to a limit, right? If we pass that limit for the stretching of a rubber band, the rubber band will break. So something similar happens to insulators. If we try to have the insulator to withstand huge amounts of electrical charge, we will get to a point where the insulator won't be able to resist. It will break, and then it will behave as a conductor. So something like that happens to air when we get lightnings in the atmosphere. When we see lightnings in the atmospheres, what happens is that the clouds in the area, they get too much electric charge, and then the air cannot withstand the opposition of the huge amount of electric charge in the cloud. So the air breaks as an insulator and it behaves as a conductor, and then we have the lightning. Something similar happens to sparking plugs in an internal combustion engine. In the terminals of the sparking plugs, we accumulate electric charge. And the amount of electric charge accumulated is so huge that the air between the terminals of the sparking plug cannot withstand. The air between the terminals of the sparking plug cannot withstand the huge amount of charge in those terminals, so it breaks, and then we have electrical flow between the terminals of the sparking plug. So, as I said, for insulators, dielectric strength is a very important property we have to take into account. Semiconductors behave either as conductors or as insulators, depending on how they were manufactured and on the operating conditions. So, what we do with a semiconductor is to have it to operate under certain conditions and to have it to behave either as a conductor or either as an insulator, depending on what we want from the device or from the system we're having to work with the semiconductor. Examples of semiconductors are silicon and germanium, which are used in the manufacture of electronic devices. Thank you for watching this tutorial. I hope you have learned something useful, and see you next time.